please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
2/3 of a percentage point higher, 0.7, 70 points higher is where the Nifty has opened, 10,227, 227 up, 220 up on the Sensex, that's also about 0.7, mid-caps 0.7, okay, it's actually moving in tandem now, the Nifty Bank as well, all equal in terms of the gains. What stands out, actually, I think it's a 50 on 50 in the green. So that's important. Bharti Airtel, Vedanta, ICICI, Tata Steel, Reliance, Axis, Indibles Housing, Adani Ports, Bajaj Finance, those are the ones. Okay, actually, I can go on. Hindalco, Gail, M&M, Dr. Reddy's, all of them up over a percent to 1%. And those that are gaining the least are Ultratech, Power Grid, NTPC is mildly in the red, very mildly. So that's the story, really. It's 0.8 now, strong start.
Yeah, just before Sonia talks about mid-cap, I just want to point out Fortis Healthcare. I think we forgot talking about it. It's out of F&O ban, and you know, there's a big gap up that's happening on Fortis Healthcare. So I just wanted to talk about that.
Oh, sorry. Absolutely. And also volumes are picking up now on Fortis. So almost a 5% up move is what we've seen there. You know, it's a really good looking screen for the broader markets as well. 1% higher, 4-1 in favor of advances. Bhushan Steel is your stock of the moment now. Almost 18% higher over there. Huge volumes coming in. You're seeing big moves come once again in IDBI Bank. 4% higher. It's been the big gainer this year, right? Almost a 40% gain there. The Adani Group stocks are bouncing back, especially the ones that, you know, have a little better asset profile, etc. So Adani Transmission is up almost about 4% right now. You have a couple of these telecom stocks. You referred to a couple of them. Idea Cellular is now up almost 4%. Relcom is up almost about 4%. So looking pretty good there. KC International is rallying on the back of the order win. So up 3% over there. Along with Adani Transmission, Adani Enterprise is also picking up. So up 3% over there. You also have a couple of these names. Let's take a look at what Amtech Auto is doing. I didn't see it feature on the volume list, but I guess there's some price action on the upside. Yes, 5%. Castex, Metalist Forging, you were referring to that. All up almost about 5-odd%. So Anuj, pretty good looking screen, almost 250 points higher on the Sensex now.
Yeah, the problem is that gap up normally gets sold into, but you know, my sense was that this market was due for 100 point short covering bounce. I think we've seen 75 points already there. Let's see if you know, there is some resistance here. Again, you're starting at about 5-1 on advance decline, so that I think could be a bit of a problem. IDBI Bank, by the way, is up another 4%, and Fortis really is your other stock to track apart from telecom stocks. But let me take this market opening to Ashwani then. Ashwani, decent opening for the market. What's the trade here now?
See, 180 points on Bank Nifty, you need to go short. I think the Nifty futures is at almost a 5-6 point discount. Earlier it was 10 points discount. Mm-hmm. So it's very clear that you know, futures traders, the big players probably at higher levels, are going short. So my sense is that even if you don't make new lows, you'll get fairly close. And the first sort of response of the market is to sell into the gap. Let's see how low we go. But I don't think it's a very positive opening, because at higher levels, it's fairly clear that selling has come back.
So you've already taken shorts, Ashwani? That's what you're saying?
Yes, we've taken shorts, and now we want to see, you know, how vicious does this selling get. Maybe it will take some time to fall, but I think this, you know, 10,230, 250 zone is going to be a trouble area. If we get past it, you know, then probably a bigger rally is on. But otherwise, I think this gap up will get sold into.
Okay. Sudarshan, anything on your list now?
Well, yes, there are two stocks apart from the Nifty where we have a long position. It's Hind Unilever and Kotak Bank. Both are for buying.
Okay. For now, ICICI Bank is the top Nifty gainer, up almost about 3-odd%, and volumes are also picking up over there, followed by Bharti Airtel. Mitesh, do you concur with Ashwini's view that this rally will get sold into quite immediately and perhaps even ferociously? Okay, I don't think I can hear.
Yeah, go ahead. It will eventually get sold into, but I'm not sure if early morning we'll see an immediate sell-off. I think we've been declining for the last 6 days, so typically I think the bounce back could be slightly more than, you know, what we're anticipating. I would still be more comfortable shorting around the 10,280 mark. For the time being, I have two stocks on the long side. Ashok Leyland has made a fresh high that should be bought, and I would also look to buy into IGL. I think that's been showing good strength for the last couple of days, and now the indicators are turning quite on the upside over here.
Okay, Balrampur Chini is down another 3%, so that's something that we pointed out in the morning as well. And of course, Fortis is your biggest gainer. Along with that, Just Dial is up about 2%. Ashok Leyland up about 2% as well. Fresh high for that one. Ashwini, so what's the big call for the day then?
See, big call is, you know, go short on this gap up and put a high of the day type of stop, because, you know, the point is not whether we are oversold or not. The point is we are very low on confidence. So I don't think, unless big players decide that this is the time to buy, you know, your retail investor is going to buy in the face of such a declining market. So a low confidence market at best can be range bound. It can't take you past, you know, strong resistances. So the idea is to get short on the Bank Nifty and at least hope for levels to come back to unchanged.
Okay. Devin, what are you doing? Are you just waiting for the markets to give you more attractive levels to buy at all?
Well, Lata, I think individual stocks have already started becoming attractive, and that's where I think your eyes should be on, because I do agree that I think you don't buy across the market everything, but the fact is that I think many of the quality stocks where the fundamentals are remaining strong, prospects are remaining strong, and they are available at a discounted valuation. Case in point is Tata Motors. I think the kind of situation in which the company is currently, I think the business condition wise they are improving significantly. Even though one has to discount the threat of higher commodity prices, I think still I believe that I think market price has discounted most of the negative aspects on that side. Similar way, I think you would find I think many other companies in the individual names, I think, which obviously I think we would not go on talking, but I think many companies are available in the marketplace where I see the opportunities around at this point of time.
Okay, Devin, we thank you on that note. By the way, the Nifty future and the Bank Nifty future are already making lows of the day. So it will be interesting to see if, you know, there's a bit of a bounce from those levels, or is this going to be again that gap up that gets sold into. For now, holding in the green, about 72 points on the Nifty. You saying something, Sonia?
No, I was also mentioning, you know, the stocks that you'd spoken about earlier in the day, PFC, REC, even we talked about PTC, all of them hitting new lows today.
Yes.
So I guess that's another pocket that
we PFC is actually a bear's delight, you know, as we spoke yesterday as well. It's not just at 52-week low, it's a multi-year low. And obviously, there's a bit of a problem here. Ashwini, thoughts on this space, PFC and REC?
See, if PSU banks are all at, you know, multi-year, multi-month highs, then, you know, where is PFC and REC? So basically everything PSU financial is going down. So I don't think much is going to come out of PFC, REC.
Yeah, right. Actually, if PSU financials go down, then PFC, REC should go down 10x.
Yeah.
Because they have exposure to only one stressed sector. At least the banks have other sectors like steel, which is
that
coming
they can
out,
hedge,
perhaps,
get a hedge from,
and retail, where they can make some money. So they are in a bad spot. When you have one sector exposure, that sector is in serious stress. In the last 4 years, we have not been able to find. We are doing ameliorative steps on DISCOMs and coal.
Yeah.
But the heart of the problem is that there are not enough buyers for power. And they're seriously over-leveraged, under-provided in equity. So those problems are not going.
Adani Power is making the lows of the day now. So, and Tata Power as well. So both Adani and Tata Power at the low point. Okay, gentlemen, thanks a lot for taking us through market opening. We'll come back to you closer to 10 a.m. Let's now invite our market master, Harsha Upadhyay, CIO Equities at Kotak Mutual Fund, is with us. Harsha, good morning. You know, we haven't yet got the mutual fund numbers for the month of February. But what's been the, study at your end, at your fund? How are the numbers for February?
February was a little moderate compared to the previous month. I won't call it beginning of a reversal in trend or anything. As it is, February had 3 days less. That could be one of the factors. Plus, the global cues were weak, and we also had some of the local factors such as unraveling of the banking fraud, introduction of LTCG, all these playing on the minds of investors. So my guess is the February numbers, even for the industry, would be a little moderate than what we have seen in January. But I think the real trend for flows from the domestic market will be known only in the next financial year, because I think even March, because of the taxation change from next year onwards, there could be some ups and downs in terms of flows. But beginning next year, I think we'll get a clear picture in terms of whether anything has changed in terms of the trend. But SIP volumes continue to remain very healthy. SIP numbers per month are right now about $1 billion. So that's heartening.
Okay. Good morning, Harsha. Thanks for joining us. Well, is it that, you know, we saw one of those days DII sell figures as well. Will there be a penchant for mutual funds to sell now and distribute a dividend before March 31st?
I don't know whether it will be an industry-wide phenomenon, but yes, there have been many dividend announcements in the industry, and usually end of the half year or end of the financial year, you do see a lot more dividends coming from the industry. And this year, again, there is going to be some increased dividends, maybe because of the taxation change that will happen from April 1st onwards. So we could see some of that, but I really do not know whether that will lead to selling in the market, because on an average, mutual funds are still holding about 5 to 6% cash. So I really don't think that there will be indiscriminate selling because of dividend announcements.
Okay. Harsha, hi, good morning. You know, we were just talking to the management of SBI, who indicated to us that the stress in the power sector is far from over. Do you expect more pressure in some of these pockets, not just the PSU banks, but even some of the you know, corporate-facing banks that have huge exposure to the power sector?
Yes, that could happen, because now we don't have CDR, SDR, S4A, JLF and all these forums and other restructuring mechanisms. So I think from September onwards, you will have to recognize some of these which are not resolved as NPAs. So that's definitely going to accelerate the pain in the corporate-facing banks to some extent. And also on top of that, we have yields hardening during this quarter, as also we had seen in the previous quarter. Which means on the PSU banking sector as a whole, there could be a hole of about 10,000 crores, give or take few thousand crores. And on top of that, you have already seen a $2 billion scam, which is only increasing in size every now and then. So all in all, I think maybe 6 months down the line, you would be looking at a similar number for recapitalization as was done in January. So that's the kind of fear that the market
so just
has.
Just a follow-up question there, because you know, you do have a presence of SBI, ICICI Bank in your top funds as well. Will you keep the faith despite the pressure seen, or do you think you could, you know, perhaps rotate or reduce the weightage here?
We have always been taking a larger bet on private sector financials, especially the ones which are focused on retail side of it. Yes, we do have some of the corporate lenders in our portfolio, but that's only a moderate position as compared to the benchmark weight. And we would continue to hold some of these. As far as the PSU banking is concerned, we have remained underweight even through the recapitalization phase. And we continue to remain underweight on the sector going forward as well.
Okay. Well, Harsha, it's clear you're getting incremental money, maybe at a slower pace. Where will you put it?
Yes, that's already been a challenge in terms of way to find value picks. So I think as asset sizes increase, as valuations remain elevated, I think the challenges are going to be more. So I don't think there are any great value picks at this point of time when market itself is trading at a higher valuation than historical averages. And especially the mid and small cap, we have seen indiscriminate buying all through 2017. So the valuations, even after the recent fall, have not really corrected in that space. So it's challenging, and I hope that market gives us time to actually build the portfolio. If markets were to move or move sideways or consolidate in a narrow range, I think that will allow portfolio managers to actually build portfolios of their choice.
Okay, by the way, market is now making a move again on the upside. So 73 points higher now on the Nifty, and 160 points higher on the Bank Nifty, 270 higher on the Sensex. So for now, it's looking like a durable move. Harsha, so you know, you spoke about portfolios. Let's talk about some portfolio positioning. What's interesting is that in your select focus fund, you have neutral on banking and underweight on IT, which are the two biggest sectors right now. So how would you approach the portfolio from here on? Because IT has done well, started to do well. And of course, banking, we've seen a severe correction already.
Yes, we have remained underweight on IT. Our thought was this is not a sector which is going to outperform benchmark earnings growth for the next 3 years. And we continue to have, continue to maintain the same view. As far as what has happened in the last one or one and a half quarters is the fact that IT sector has moved up in relation to the market, and that in our view is coming from two factors. One, the positioning of most of the portfolios, including ours, where there has been an underweight position. So underwound sector has performed in the last few quarters, and IT has been no exception. And secondly, there has been some bit of valuation catch up. I think post the buyback that we saw in the sector, the valuations corrected a little bit, and that offered some kind of a respite for people who are getting consistent flows, and money has moved into this particular sector. But our view remains that the earnings growth trajectory for IT companies is unlikely to increase much beyond what is there in most of the estimates at this point of time. And we believe that some of the domestic stories will possibly have better earnings growth and better visibility for the next 2 to 3 years. Yes, we'll have to wait through this volatile period where being a defensive sector, IT is possibly giving you that comfort. But once the dust settles, I think domestic businesses will outperform IT sector.
Okay. Well, Harsha, is debt an attraction at all?
I manage only equity assets.
I know. But you are impacted if the attraction is higher.
True. Thankfully, that happens with a lag. When the interest rates starts going up, the equity markets start to have impact on the valuations or on the corporate profitability only with a lag.
Mm.
But we do believe that at this point of time, the interest rate hikes, even if that is not going to happen in the short term, but at least the bias is going to be neutral to higher levels of interest rates in the system. And even without a formal hike, we have already seen yields moving up quite a bit, the lending rates going up quite a bit.
Okay.
So we have already witnessed a kind of a reversal in trend.
Okay.
So I think we'll have to watch out how fast that will continue going forward.
What's your worst case, Harsha? I mean, what kind of a fall are you prepared for? Already the small cap index has fallen 17% from its January highs. How much of a loss can you think the mid-cap index can see and the Nifty can see?
It will be very, very difficult to predict some of the short-term movements or the targets. As far as mid and small cap is concerned, I think last calendar year they outperformed large cap space by 1.5x. I mean, when large caps gave about 30% returns, the mid and small cap index gave in excess of 45%, and most of the mid and small cap which are underowned, which are illiquid, have gone up much more than 45%. So definitely, and this is on the back of the fact that for the last 2 or 3 years anyways the valuations on the mid and small caps were elevated. So to an extent, even with the recent correction which has been quite sharp in this segment, we haven't really seen valuations correcting to our comforting levels. So we would remain biased towards large caps. And as far as the large cap index is concerned, I think this year the returns are going to be more moderate definitely as compared to 2017. And also the volatility will be much higher than what we have witnessed in the previous year.
All right, Harsha, we leave it at that. Thanks so much for joining us and speaking to CNBC TV 18. By the way, for the market, it's still holding with gains of about 70-odd points, but it's IT once again that's leading from the front. Infosys, HCL Tech, all up in the green. So this seems to be the trend, right? Whether the market sells off or not, a pocket that does quite well these days is IT.
Yes, and I think that weight adjustment is well and truly on now. If you see the IT index and the bank, Sonia, and that might be a healthy process for the market. By the way, I just want to point out, just keep an eye on the advanced decline, because that started at about 4:1 and the mid-cap index is already underperforming. And this actually is a reflection of the fact that so many people right now are hurting in their portfolios. And what happens is, especially on a gap up, the temptation is to just sell some of your stocks, you know, where you're making so many losses. And if you have that kind of gap up, 7:1, 5:1 advanced decline, your first instinct is to get out of the stocks. And that's why you're seeing mid-cap. If any index turns into the red, I think the first one would be the mid-cap index. So that's just a bit of a warning sign here. But weekly options expiry as well, so things could get really interesting today.
Yeah. No, I just wanted to say that the key takeaway from Harsha was that inflows into mutual funds was more moderate in February than January.
Yes.
And January was 15,000 crore versus 20,000 crore in December.
Yeah.
So now it becomes 2-month trend. You know, it's not just a one-off. We will have to watch it. As he says, February is a shorter month. And therefore, anyway, you should get 10% less because there are 10% fewer working days. But let's see. That that was such a big source of liquidity for
us. Exactly. And which is the unfortunate part, right? Because all through last year...
When things were high, exactly, people were buying.
But that is equity market.
But that's generally a trend that
you see,
right?
You know, you invest in a roaring bull market. Mm. The maximum money is made when you actually buy into a bear market, because then when the next bull market comes, you make most money.
Okay, easier said than done though. Let's get back to stocks now. KC International is one stock on our radar. Just a while back, they announced order wins worth nearly 1400 crores across various business segments. Vimal Kejriwal, the MD and CEO, joins in now to give us more details on that. Vimal, good morning. Tell us a little bit about this order, and also the last time when we spoke with you, you had indicated that the current unexecuted order book stands at about 17,000 odd crores. With these orders that you've received recently, what is the order book now?
So two things. One, if you look at the order breakup, roughly 57% of these are from the transmission sector and around 34% are from the railways, and the rest are cable, civil, etc. As far as the order book is concerned, we are still at around the same number because we have also done execution in the last 2 months, since we spoke. So overall, order book plus L1 is around 20,000 crores.
Okay. Good morning, Vimal. You know, but the power sector is a bit stressed, though, of course, transmission is not. And separately, the government will be in its last home stretch before the next election. Will this at all affect order flow for you? For the next 12 months, that is?
To me, actually, let's say for the next 6 months, we'll see a lot more orders coming in.
Oh, I see.
It's only in the last 6 months that, order starts, they get into the flow where they stop giving orders. Mm. But next 6 months, we are actually more positive than before.
Okay. Is there any improvement in margins or the other way around because raw material prices have gone up?
What happens is that most of these orders, in fact, almost everything is from India except the Jordan order. These are all pass-through orders where the metal prices are, paid on the date on which we supply. So there's no impact on the margin as such.
So between transmission and railways, you said you gave us the breakup, but now where are you seeing the highest amount of demand and orders coming from?
Relatively speaking, it is railways because, our order intake for railways is now more than 3,000 crores for the year, which is a record for us. But overall, since transmission as such is a bigger vertical for us, the absolute number for transmission is higher, but the relative growth in railways is much higher.
Okay. Well, this is a question which Anisha has sent to us. She's our researcher who follows your stock very closely. Yeah. She's pointing out that the nine-month top-line growth is 10%, although your last quarter was 20% higher. Yeah. So are you confident of your guidance of 15 to 20% growth?
No, if you see our last quarter guidance, we've been talking about 10 to 15% growth.
Okay, okay.
And that's where I think we should be. Had the GST impact not been there, probably we would have been higher than that.
All right, fair enough. Okay, we'll leave it at that. Sorry, you want to ask something?
No, that's it. Thank you so much, Vimal, for joining us. So that's interesting. They're seeing a lot more orders coming from the railway segment, although that's a very small part of their business currently, with KC International up 2.5%. But as we celebrate Women's Day today, it's only pertinent that we speak to some of the women who are making a difference to our society. Among them is Telecom Secretary Aruna Sundararajan, and she joins us now on the show. Good morning, Ms. Sundararajan. Happy Women's Day to you. What is the message to aspiring women who, say, want to join the IAS? Any mantras to succeed in what is still called a man's world?
First of all, I think, both the government and the IAS really have many more women than you see in many other professions. So I think it's a less discriminatory environment, really. And we're fortunate to have that. Now, the fact that one is in the IAS, is a privileged position. So I guess a lot of my achievements I will really have to attribute to the fact that, one is in a profession where you are in a leadership role all along. But I think the message that is important is we need to give many more opportunities to young aspiring women. I mean, we have such phenomenally talented young women, but we, many of them just don't get the kind of opportunities that I or you have. So the key thing is to ensure that no matter what field, and particularly in fields like technology and science, we have to go out there and you know, encourage and make sure that we do everything to open up those opportunities to women.
Okay. I do my bit, ma'am. I can promise you that we have a lot of young women in CNBC. But well, we'll try and come back to the women questions in a bit. I can't not ask you about telecom questions. Just yesterday, the government did extend spectrum payment timelines. But, you know, telecom is still a highly stressed sector and a highly taxed sector. If you count GST, license fee, spectrum usage charge, it is even now taxed at about 30%. Is there any rethink on any of these?
See, the government has already set up an IMG to specifically look at the issues of stress in the telecom sector. And I think we are moving to the final phase of decision making on that. On the larger issue of whether the telecom sector, you know, the levies are high, I think we have heard voices from the industry which have said that, you know, levies are on the high side. The TRAI in its recommendations given to the ministry on the new telecom policy have also suggested a certain easing up, primarily from the point of view of ensuring that, you know, investments go into creating the networks that, you know, Digital India needs. So the telecom ministry is, you know, looking into the recommendations that have been received. We're looking into the points made by industry, and we'll attempt to address them in the policy.
Okay. By the way, the mid-cap index is almost in the red. It's up only about 15 points now. And just keep an eye on PSU banks, Canara Bank in particular, for last many days now. That you know, is the one which has led the decline in the PSU banking pack, and once again making lows of the morning. So don't know, something wrong with the stock for last two or three days.
Yes Bank is showing a lot of pain.
Yes, so there is clearly a bit of a pain in the banking space that's not going away easily. But Mr. Sundararajan, good morning. Will there be any move to align our domestic spectrum prices to global prices?
See, spectrum pricing, as you know, it's really, since we do it transparently through auctions, it's really a question of supply and demand, right? So in the past, you know, we have seen that there's been huge competition for spectrum, and that is because people were trying to build up their networks. So I think really it's really a function of the market.
Okay. Can you update us on the latest with respect to the BharatNet project? I mean, how many villages have been covered so far, and what's the progress?
Yeah, so I'm happy to share with you that, you know, we have today 100,000 gram panchayats which are on BharatNet. And we expect that you know, in the next phase, which will complete the next 1,50,000 gram panchayats, that work is already commenced in quite a few states. Many of the states have taken the lead. So whether it's Chhattisgarh, Gujarat, Andhra, Telangana, Tamil Nadu, Jharkhand, all these states have come forward to take up implementation in the next phase. So we see that there's going to be, we expect that there will be a lot of acceleration. Now the effort really is to ensure that the key governance, economic and social institutions in the gram panchayats start utilizing broadband, because it's only when utilization happens that you will really see the benefits. But let me also mention here that there's a big push to create rural Wi-Fi so that we will be able to provide broadband on the mobile to rural citizens who haven't had it. So in the next phase, we will be creating about 5 lakh Wi-Fi hotspots. And I think then we'll really see, you know, BharatNet, the impact of BharatNet on rural India.
Well, let me come back to the stress in the sector, Mr. Sundararajan. You know, the industry has consolidated from over a dozen players to now just three, either bought up or in NCLT, many of them. Will the government worry that, you know, the number of players have declined so much?
The world over, you know, every country, whether it's the US, whether it's China, every country because of the nature of the investments that are required in the telecom sector, you have either a two-player or a three-player market at best. And I think so in that sense, India is completely in conformity or in alignment with what's happening globally. So having, you know, three strong players, I think, is a good position for India to be in.
Okay.
Okay, that's about the sector. But coming back, since we're celebrating Women's Day, I have to ask this to you. You know, the recent Maternity Benefit Act allows 6 months leave and makes providing creche facilities mandatory as well. It's helped a lot of women. But can we say that the law has sufficiently empowered the young mother now?
I think we have come a long way. And this is certainly a major step in the direction of ensuring that, you know, women who are of a particular age, you know, do get an opportunity also to attend to their families. So I'm not sure that it's really a lack of legal safeguards that's the problem. See, the challenge that we have in India is really much more complex than that. And I think it is really to do with the fact that women, you know, right from the beginning are in an environment where they are expected to behave differently, expected to do different things, expected to respond differently. So I think it's much more complex, much more deeply entrenched than something that can be attributed to a lack of laws. I think on laws, actually, India does, you know, fairly well. We have some of the most progressive laws anywhere.
Yep. No, I take your point on that. Thank you very much, Mrs. Sundararajan, and have a great year ahead. Thank you very much for joining us on what's a special day for us here at CNBC TV 18. And I take Mrs. Sundararajan's point on the law as well. Mm. In fact, I used to worry that the six-month benefit could actually be counterproductive. A lot of people while hiring may wonder whether this works against the woman.
Yeah. Should they hire or not?
Yeah. So, you know, sometimes too much of benefit can also cut both ways.